I don't know. Some of you guys got favorite Disney movies out there? Yeah? What's some of your favorites? Let me hear. What's some of your favorite Disney movies? What's some of your favorite Disney movies? Oh, okay, okay. Jim, you got any?
I can see what's happening.
What?
He hasn't got a clue.
Who?
Can you feel the love tonight?
What was that? What about this one?
I can show you the world. Shining, shimmering, splendid. Tell me, princess, now hinted. You must let your heart decide.
Wait, what's that? Oh, okay.
I want to go way back. When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are.
Pinocchio. What about this one?
Disney too, right? Well, we today, if you haven't guessed already, we are going to be talking about the gospel according to Disney, and we're going to talk about the Lion King. Everybody say the Lion King.
Lion King.
That's it. So I'm so excited about this, but let me give you some crazy facts about the Lion King. Do you know, the original movie, it came out in 1994. It was the highest grossing movie of its time. Isn't that crazy? And so recently, last year, it hit the box offices again, and they did this different version of it. Anybody ever seen that version yet? They did this version of it, and it was the second highest grossing film in the billions. Good night, Disney's making a lot of money, amen? And it was the second highest grossing movie. Do you know what it was second to? The Avengers. Isn't that something? Another Disney movie. So what I'm going to be doing throughout this sermon is I am going to be giving a lot of spoilers of The Lion King, but in my defense, it's been out for 25 years, so if you haven't seen it already, that's on you, okay? So we're going to be talking about it, and I'm excited. So I'm going to give you a little bit of background of what happens, and I'm sure you know it, but the story revolves around this little lion cub, and what's his name, guys? Simba. Everybody say Simba. So the story revolves around Simba, and he lives in the kingdom of Pride Rock, And this is really, it's a utopian kingdom, if you will. This Pride Rock, this kingdom, is the perfect kingdom where all the animals can live. I mean, beautiful plants, the animals are gorgeous. Everything is in their favor. And but every single animal in the kingdom has a role to play. I want you to follow me, guys. Every single animal in the kingdom has their specific calling in their life. They have a specific role that they are supposed to play, and Simba was no different. He also had a specific calling in the kingdom of Pride Rock, and for him, his future was to be the next Lion King. And he was actually presented in front of the whole kingdom with his calling, and I'm sure you can remember that when Rafiki, one of my favorite characters, took him up, and he anointed him and then presented him. Watch this, will you? Isn't that amazing? So you take this little cub, and he's presented with his calling. He was basically anointed into his calling. And it's so amazing because we got to do a baby dedication this morning. And when I was able to dedicate little Kingston, it's the same principle that we get to talk about, that we took that precious baby and we dedicated him to the service of our Lord. And that's exactly what happens in regards to each and every one of us. When we come into this life, when we come into this world, God has planted in each and every single one of us a calling that he wants you and me to fulfill. He has set you aside. He has set me aside to perform, to fulfill a certain calling. And so early on in the movie, what happens is we see Simba and his father. Anybody know his father's name? Mufasa. They were taking a walk together, and Mufasa was helping him understand the importance of the kingdom, helping him understand how the kingdom works and how every single animal has a specific role to play, how every single animal has a specific calling to fulfill. And I said, man, this sounds pretty familiar to us as Christ followers, right? It sounds pretty familiar to us as God's children, how God, from the very beginning of time, knew exactly what he wanted you and me to fulfill. And my question this morning is, do you feel like you are in a place right now where you are fulfilling the calling that God has on your life? Do you feel like right now that you are fulfilling that very thing that God has set aside for you to do? Mufasa wanted his son to understand the importance of his calling, and so he kind of takes him on a little trip and explains to him what that looks like. Watch this clip. So he takes him into this journey to explain to him what his calling is all about, what he needs to look forward to. And so you kind of know how the story begins to unfold. Our calling, just like Simba's, can sometimes get interrupted. Sometimes what happens in life is we can get to a place where things and life happens and it gets in the way of us fulfilling our calling. Sometimes negativity can get in the way of us fulfilling our calling. Sometimes there's naysayers in our life. Have you ever had somebody in your life that you've been so excited about getting something accomplished or doing something for God, and it seems like they're telling you all the reasons why it won't work? You know, and instead of encouraging your plan of completing something for our God, they're giving you all the reasons why you shouldn't or you can't. Well, I'm here to tell you, if God put a plan on your life, ain't nobody can stop that plan. All right? And if God has a calling on your life, there's nobody that can slow it down. You have to be the one to say, I've got what it takes. God has planted something special in me. I'm here today, and I'm going to fulfill it. And so we've got to trust that. We've got to want that. But what happened is something happened to Simba. There was another lion, an evil lion, and he was Simba's uncle. And you know what his name was? Scar, that's right, his name was Scar. And he had an entire motive through this entire movie, and it was for him to get to the throne. Because see, what happened is, and this will preach, there's so many messages in here, but what happened is you had his brother, Mufasa, who was the king. And Scar, he was more focused on somebody else's calling than he was his own. And so that's, I started to think, man, that sounds like us in life. Sometimes we could be so focused on what somebody else can do good that we're not focusing on what I can do. You understand what I'm saying? Well, man, I wish I could get up there and sing. I wish I was a preacher. I wish I could get up there and build a house. I wish I could do this. What can you do that's good? And can we begin to focus on what we can do and stop focusing on what everybody else can do? And that's exactly what's happened here. So Scar realizes there's only two things that are getting in the way of him getting what he wants. And it's Simba and Mufasa. So you know what happens. Scar lures Simba into a wildebeest stampede. You remember that scene? And all of a sudden the wildebeests come and Simba is running for his dear life. His dad, Mufasa, gets word, and he gets to the stampede as quick as possible, does everything in his power to save his son, gets his son to safety, tries to climb up the cliff, and as he gets to the top of the cliff, who is there to greet him? Scar. And what does Scar do instead of helping him up? He what? He pushes him down. Mufasa dies. And then from that point on, Scar goes to Simba and tells him to run away. But in his attempt to run away, he tells these nasty, negative hyenas to go chase him and kill him. So they're under the impression that he dies and that Scar now becomes king. You see, Simba, he has a calling. He runs away from his calling. But it's not until he realizes who he truly is and who is in him that he's able to go back and accept his calling. You and me today, and we're about to unfold it. You and me today, we have a calling. Sometimes we run away from our calling. And I'm here to tell you, it's not going to be until we see who we are and who Christ is in us, that we'll be able to fulfill that calling. So here we go. I believe that there is a little bit of the Lion King in each and every one of us today. So here's the big idea. We all have a calling. We all have a role to fulfill. And we all have a time frame to do it. You know, I know that the social media and the news, it's all been swarming right now about Kobe Bryant, right? And about all of the people in that plane that lost their lives and how sad that was. And one thing I took away from that was that none of us are promised tomorrow. And so what we have to understand is that if we have a role and a calling to fulfill, we're not promised tomorrow, so church, it's time that we get and we start to do what we're supposed to be doing. You say, Pastor, are you sure that I have a calling? You don't know me. I'm a little crazy. Yes, you do. And the question today is what will your response be to that? You say, well, how are you pairing this to God's word? Well, there's so much that you could, but one story specifically just kind of stepped out to me, and it's the story of Moses. Everybody remember Moses? And so Moses had an encounter with the burning bush. You remember that? God appeared to Moses in this burning bush, and this is what it said. Now, follow me through this story, and we'll see how it kind of relates. In Exodus chapter 3, verses 7 through 10, it says this. Then the Lord told him, I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I have heard their cries of distress because they're harsh slave drivers. Yes, I am aware of their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the power of the Egyptians and lead them out of Egypt into their own fertile and spacious land. It is a land flowing with milk and honey, the land where the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites now live. Look, the cry of the people of Israel has reached me, and I have seen how harshly the Egyptians abused them. What God is saying is, listen, Moses, I've been taking a watch. I can see my children in Egypt, they're being abused. They're being treated badly, and I've got to do something about it, and I want you to help me. Now listen what it says in verse 10. This is Moses' calling. Understand this. This is the calling that God gave to Moses. Right here. Now go, I am sending you to Pharaoh. You must lead my people Israel out of Egypt. That's Moses' calling. Now go, I'm sending you to Pharaoh. You must lead my people Israel out of Egypt. He's got a calling on his life right there. This is what I want us to understand. Every single person in the building today, we all have a calling for the kingdom of God. Usually, a lot of times when people hear about a calling, they want to typically automatically associate it to somebody in the church. They think a calling is for pastors. They think a calling is for leaders in the church or staff members in the church. And those are the people that have a calling in the kingdom of God. However, nothing could be further from the truth. Turn to your neighbor right now and say, you have a calling. Some of y'all just told them like that like you really didn't even believe it. God set Moses apart for a purpose. You know, as we did that baby dedication earlier, you remember how I said that before God formed the world, before God formed the universe, that he had a calling for us in our life? It says that in 2 Timothy. It says that he called us before the beginning of time. That in John chapter 15, God tells us that we didn't choose him, but that he chose us for a specific calling to fulfill. He chose us to bear fruit. When God started to form us in the womb, he started to create our personality. He started to create us with a certain skill set. He started to create us with certain desires and certain passions. And you know how you begin to figure those out? I believe that you and I can figure out our calling together by asking ourselves some questions. Start to ask yourself stuff like this. What are things that you love to do? Think about that. Think about it. What are some things that you love to do? Some people like to talk. I like to talk. Pastor Bill definitely likes to talk. You know? What are things, listen to this. What are things that you are just naturally good at? Think about it. What are things that you're naturally good at? Now, I'm not good at everything. I know that's a big surprise, but I'm not good at everything. There's a lot of stuff that I don't know how to do. There's stuff that I am good at. If you put a hammer in my hand, I'm not going to fix anything. It's just not good at it. If you need me to go help build a Habitat home, Ma, you got the wrong son. You're going to have to go to Angel. You know, I'm not a builder. If you tell me, hey, I've got something wrong with my car and it sounds like this, guess what? I ain't going to be able to help you fix it. But if you call me and you say, hey, I just got my house built, I need somebody to come give me their opinion on how to decorate it, I'll make that house look like $1 million quick. I mean, your house will be popping if you have me come and help decorate it, okay? I got an eye for it, okay? It's something that I'm good at. I'm not good at everything. Another thing that I'm not good at, I'm just being transparent. You know what today is, right? It's the what? The Super Bowl, okay? Ask me something about sports. I ain't gonna know. I'm showing up to the Super Bowl party for the food, not even to watch the game. I'm just being truthful. Talking about blue 42. What's 42, buddy? I don't know that. You know, but it's just how we're different. We all know certain things. Some of us are good at things. Some of us are not. And it's okay. The key here is to understand what you're good at and play to those strengths. But, there's a big but. Sometimes God will use something in you and me that we're not even good at just so he can shine and we won't. So what will happen, church, is there might be something that God calls you to do and you think God's crazy. It's not that God's crazy. It's that when you get done doing the task, you're not going to walk away and say, look what I just did. You're going to walk away saying, I only was able to do this because he did it through me. That's what we have to understand, church. What area of ministry, what area of mission gets you excited? What are the things that you truly love to do? Let me ask you guys this. We all do different things for work, right? Alex, you're still a flight attendant, right? Right? I mean, this guy has been a flight attendant for how many years? 14 years, okay? And it's not the fact that he's just a flight attendant on a plane. But take somebody who's flying for the first time, and they're nervous as all get out. And if he's able to just to walk up to that person and say, hey, let me just say a little prayer with you to calm you down. Huh? Right? You know, think about your jobs and what you do. You know, you got Adrian and Ace back there. They're barbers. Say somebody sits in their chair and they're nervous or they're having a bad day. You know how it is, ladies. When y'all go to the beauty shop, y'all want to tell everybody your problems, right? And so guys, when they want a chance to just to sit down and to let it unload, they could be there what? And minister to the people who are sitting in their chairs. Ma, you told me the other day, she just felt, everybody say, hey, Miss Nancy. I love her so much. And Mom told me the other day, she said, you know, son, I've really felt this calling to be a prayer warrior for the Joy FM. And so she's contacted the Joy FM, and she's had to go through this training because she's going to be getting calls from people just so she could pray for them. Sometimes we have to figure out, and guess what? Everybody that calls her, it's not going to be just a simple prayer. They're preparing her for every type of prayer you could even experience. People that are struggling with an addiction. She said, you might even get a call where somebody said, hey, I'm playing the lotto right now. Can you pray that I hit the best numbers? You know, I know it's, but she said they warned her that you can get anything. You got to be prepared for it, whatever it might be. God has a calling on each and every single one of our lives, and we have to be ready to fulfill it, to build up others' faith in Christ. Okay, so we all have a calling to fulfill. Now, we all have a choice. Everybody say you got a choice to fulfill that calling for the kingdom of God. Now listen to this. Moses. Now this is where it gets good. Moses gave God all the reasons why he could not accept the call. Now I'm going to need y'all to follow along with this. Okay? This is good stuff right here. Moses gave God all the reasons why he could not accept his call to lead the people Israel out of Egypt. This is what he tells God. He says, who am I to tell these people? What if they don't believe me? What if they don't listen? Now let me give you a little background about Moses. So check this out. When Moses was born, there was a decree in all the land that all the firstborn sons would be killed. You remember that? Okay, so what happens? So Moses' mother, this is crazy. Moses' mom puts Moses as an infant child into a what? A basket. She places that basket in a river, in the Nile. Now watch me. This is crazy. She puts the basket with her baby in the basket, Moses, into a body of water, into the Nile River, guys. Imagine, Pastor Bill, somebody putting a baby in a basket down the Gatlinburg, the Pigeon Forge River. For real. She puts her baby in this basket. Moses travels as an infant in a basket along the Nile River, and he gets into the backyard of who? Pharaoh. The house of Pharaoh. Pharaoh's family notices, what's, there's a basket, what is this? They go out, get the basket, find that it's a baby boy. Beg Pharaoh to keep the baby. Moses, an Israelite, was raised as an Egyptian. He wasn't just raised as an Egyptian, but he was raised in the house of Pharaoh. This is getting good. He was raised as an heir to the throne. He was next in line to be the king of Egypt, but he was really an Israelite. He was raised with privilege. He was raised with power. He was raised with money. He was raised with prestige. And what happens is one day he decides that he realizes who he is. Church. He realizes who he is. He leaves the throne of Egypt. He leaves it to go to Israel, to go to another land. He leaves his power. He leaves all the money. He leaves his purpose of being king in Egypt, just not realizing it was his purpose to be the leader of Israel. So he leaves. He has an encounter with God in a burning bush. God appears to Moses in the form of fire in a burning bush, and he calls him to lead the people, his people Israel, out of the hand of Egypt, where he just left. Now this is what it says. God tells him to go. Exodus chapter 4, verse 10, it says this. But Moses pleaded with the Lord. Oh Lord, I'm not very good with words. I never have been, and I'm not now. Even though you have spoken to me, I get tongue-tied and my words get tangled. Then the Lord asked Moses, who makes a person's mouth? Who decides whether people speak or do not speak? Hear or do not hear? See or do not see? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, again the calling. I will be with you as you speak, and I will instruct you in what to say. Listen to me. I love it. It's like Moses tells God, God, I can't go. I can't even speak right. And God says, well, who made your mouth, baby boy? Moses says, but God, I don't even know what words to say. Well, who can make you talk, baby boy? You and me. But God, I'm not good at that. You want me to do this? You're calling me to do this? You know that's not in me. Moses attempted to inform God that that's just the way he is. Everybody say, that's just the way I am. Say it again. Turn to your neighbor and say, look, that's just the way I am. I want you to know something. Hear me out. Y'all ready? God's take is this. I will give an ability far beyond human ability. I made your mouth, and I'm perfectly capable of operating it. Now, speech, listen to me. Follow me real quick. Speech was important to Moses. And the reason speech was important to Moses is because in Egyptian culture, it meant something if you knew how to speak right. If you were eloquent with your words, if you knew how to speak, you looked as you were a distinguished person. So it was already tripping Moses out that he wasn't a good speaker. So he had to basically say, God, I can't do this. You want me to go back to the people that I just left? I'm not even a good speaker. Because he knew how important it was to be that. Here again, I believe that God specifically wanted Moses to go with the lack of eloquence because God wanted his work to be seen, not Moses. What was Simba's excuse? Why did he run from his calling? Simba's excuse was guilt. Simba's excuse was fear. Anybody in here feel heavy with guilt today? You don't have to raise your hand, but anybody in here feeling heavy with guilt about something? What about this? Simba also ran. His excuse was fear. Anybody in here today, are you fearful about anything? You see, he had the death of his father on his mind and in his heart, even though he didn't do it. So he was walking around with a bunch of guilt, a bunch of fear. And you know what? A lot of times, you and me, we give this excuse that we just said, that's just the way I am, while we can't fulfill a calling. You know what? Some people say this. Follow me for a second. I can't lead a small group. I'm an introvert. That's just the way I am. Some of us get caught up in conversations and we say, I say things that I don't mean to say. I have a hot temper. That's just the way I am. I talk loud and abrasive. You know how I was raised. You know where I'm from. Everybody talks loud and abrasive. I'm just going to use the excuse. That's just the way I am. I have anger problems. I get it from my parents. That's just the way I am. I can't give all that you want me to give, God, because I'm a saver. I'm a tight spender. You know how frugal I am. That's just the way I am. People say, you know what, Pastor Aaron, if you knew how my finances were, I live paycheck to paycheck. I can't afford to give God's kingdom anything. I don't have enough for myself. My thing is I believe we can't afford not to give God anything. Because all I know is if I want to keep being blessed and provided for and watched over, I need to show my faithfulness by giving back to him what he's given to me. Church, try him. Try him. I know it can be, listen, because I'm just like you. I've went through some tight financial experiences lately where it's kind of kept me very tight, and I've even had to think to myself, Lord, this week is pretty tight. I don't know if I can, maybe if I can just skip this week of giving to you. And the moment I begin to think like that, God says, let me tell you something, don't skip out on me, because I'm not never going to skip out on you. We have what we have because he's allowed us to have it. Try him. You say, but you don't know how. Try him. Let the tightness be your testimony. Let the tightness of your bills be the testimony of your provision. I can't, listen, some people say this, well, Pastor Aaron, you just don't know. I can't lead this group, or I can't do this. My attention span is not good. I can't give somebody my undivided attention. I got ADD. That's just the way I am, Pastor Bill. This is me. Let me preach to myself. Watch this. Some of us are like this. I'm too organized to rearrange my agenda. That's just the way I am. I got to follow this checklist. And if I'm not checking off my list, my week is going to be shot. And I can't do that. I will drive myself crazy if I can't do what I need to do on my list. I'm way too organized for anything else. That's just the way I am. I can't sacrifice any more of my time. I'm a busy person. You don't know how my schedule is. I go to work, I go to the gym, I go to family. I go to work, go to the gym. I don't have any time for anything else, God. I know you want me to do this. I know you want me to show up on Sundays, but listen, Sundays, I got to rest. Well, what does God do for us that we can't just turn around and give a little bit back to him? It's not like God is asking you and me to give a lot, but sometimes we put God on the back burner and we don't allow him to take the place that he rightfully has. And we wonder why life is a mess. Listen, I'm preaching to myself. We've got to make the time that God wants for us. I tell you, you're going through issues in your life. Maybe you might be going through a marital problem. Maybe you might be going through a financial issue. Maybe you might be going through a health issue and you just got some news, or you were diagnosed with something that you don't know how you're going to deal with. Maybe you're going through an issue right now with your kids and you're just not seeing eye to eye with your kids, and maybe you're hurting and it's keeping you up all night. God says, stop putting me second and seek me first, and everything else will fall into place. Listen, sometimes we tend not to seek God until we get comfortable to seek him. What is God calling you to do? I can't enjoy worship today. I can't come to church every Sunday. I just have my reasons why. You know, if the worship doesn't sound like this, matter of fact, I'm old-fashioned. I want everybody to be dressed a certain way, so it just kind of gets in my way a little bit. I'm just old-fashioned. I'm set in my ways, God. That's just the way I am. I can't lead somebody to Christ. Some people might say this. I'm not smart enough. Matter of fact, I have a learning disability. The Bible sometimes can be a little bit hard to comprehend. That's just the way I am. Listen, not only do you and I, not only do we have this thought in our mind that that's just the way we are, but sometimes we have a tendency to give God an ultimatum. God, I will fulfill the calling that you have for me in my life. I will fulfill the calling if you allow me to do this. It's just, if you allow me to become a millionaire, God, then I'll start to give. If you allow me to have gifts like this person, then I'll start to serve. So here we go. We all have a calling. We're almost done. We all have a calling. We all have a choice to fulfill that calling. And last but not least, we all have the counsel to fulfill our calling for the kingdom of God. We have the calling. We have a choice to fulfill the calling. We also have the counsel we need to get the calling done. You say, Pastor, what counsel do we have? Number one, we got to remember who we are. Will you watch this with me? Remember who we are.
Creepy little monkey. Will you stop following me? Who are you?
The question is, who are you?
I thought I knew. Now I'm not so sure.
Well, I know who you are. Shh, come here. It's a secret.
Enough already. What is that supposed to mean, anyway?
It means you're a baboon. And I'm not.
I think you're a little confused.
Wrong. I'm not the one who's confused. You don't even know who you are.
Oh, and I suppose you know.
Sure do. You're Mufasa's boy. Bye.
Hey, wait! You knew my father?
Correction. I know your father.
I hate to tell you this, but he died a long time ago.
Nope. Wrong again. He's alive. And I'll show him to you. You follow old Rafiki. He knows the way. Come on. Don't dawdle. Hurry up.
Whoa, wait, wait.
Come on. Come on.
Would you slow down?
Come on.
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
Simba, you have forgotten me.
No. How could I?
You have forgotten who you are, and so forgotten me. Look inside yourself, Simba. You are more than what you have become. You must take your place in the circle of life.
How can I go back? I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son, and the one true king. Remember who you are.
No, please, don't leave me.
Remember.
Father.
Remember.
What was that? The weather. Very peculiar, don't you think?
Yeah. Looks like the winds are changing.
Change is good.
Yeah, but it's not easy. I know what I have to do, but going back means I'll have to face my past. I've been running from it for so long. Ow! Jeez, what was that for?
It doesn't matter. It's in the past.
Yeah, but it still hurts.
Oh, yes, the past can hurt. But the way I see it, you can either run from it or learn from it. Ah, you see? So what are you going to do?
First, I'm going to take your stick.
No, not a stick. Hey, where are you going?
I'm going back.
Good. Go on, get out of here.
I mean, that was a message right there, right? I mean, go ahead, Rafiki, Pastor Rafiki. You know, the thing is we have to remember who we are in Christ. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. Ephesians 2:10 says, for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. God has planned good things for your life long ago. And I know we want to say that's just not the way I am. I'm not good enough. I'm not ready. And instead, can we learn to say, I can because I'm a new creation in Christ. I am God's masterpiece. Turn to your neighbor right now and say, you are a new creation in Christ. Tell him. Turn to your neighbor and say, you are a masterpiece. Tell him, you are a real piece of work. Man, y'all got loud on that one. All right. But remember, listen, we're almost done. Remember, God had to remind Moses that God created him, and he is the one who determines who speaks and does not speak, who gives a person a mouth. It's time for you and me to remember who we are, not who we were. We cannot focus on the past anymore. Listen. Just like Simba said, the past hurts. But we can't allow the shame and the guilt of life hold us back or hold us down anymore. Some of us are living with shame. Some of us are living with guilt. But we got to release it to God. The past hurts. But like Rafiki said, we can either run from it or learn from it. You see, he hit Simba over the head with the staff the first time and it hurts. The second time he went to hit him, what happened? He ducked. Some of you guys need to learn how to duck. We keep allowing ourselves to get hit over the head with what life throws us. Life throws at us problem after problem, and we stand there and just keep getting knocked out, and God's saying, learn to duck. Learn from it. Don't run from it. Some of us have done the opposite. We haven't just sat there and been hit by it, but we just keep running. Some of us don't even know how to address a problem. When a problem arises, it's there, and we act like it never happened the next day after, or the third day after, or a week after. Some people are walking around with hurt that they've been carrying for years because they never addressed it. Learn from it or run from it. And in closing, you know how we all have the counsel, and our counsel is this: not only remembering who we are, but lastly, recognizing what we can do through Christ. My favorite verse: I can do all things through what? The Message translation, my favorite way it says it: whatever I have, wherever I am, I can make it through anything in the one who makes me who I am. Whatever I have, wherever I am, I can make it through anything in the one who makes me who I am. Matter of fact, if we can learn to depend on God's power, not ours, instead of us giving this excuse, "That's just the way I am," why don't we learn to say, "I do what I do, and I am what I am, because that's just the way Jesus is." Can you say that with me? It's in your bulletin. It's up on the screen. Ready? I do what I do, and I am what I am, because that's just the way Jesus is. Say it again. I do what I do, I am what I am, because that's just the way Jesus is. So this is what I got to say. Why do we help hurting people, church? That's just the way Jesus is. Why do we forgive those who have hurt us? That's just the way Jesus is. Why do we feed the hungry every week? That's just the way Jesus is. Why do we show and give grace instead of condemnation and judgment to other people? Because that's just the way Jesus is. Why do we love the unlovable? Because that's just the way what? Jesus is. Why do we serve with no limitation? That's just the way. Why do we let somebody skip us in line at Walmart just to show Jesus? Because that's just the way. Why do we let somebody get what they want instead of us getting what we want sometimes? Because that's just what? The way. Why do you leave what you want to do and leave your agenda to the side to help serve somebody else? Because that's what? Just the way. Why do we come here every Sunday? Because what, baby? That's just what? The way who? Jesus is. Listen, church, why do we see that homeless person on the side of the street and you feel compelled to give a few dollars? Because that's what? What are you doing today? What are you doing today in your life right now that you said that you can say, "I'm doing this because that's just the way Jesus is"? My question is if we don't have nothing to say that we're doing it just because that's the way Jesus is, then that's a problem. I'm not coming down on anybody. I'm not judging us. But we got to start doing some stuff in our life because that's just the way Jesus is. Listen, some of us, instead of me talking about my problems or somebody else's problems on social media, why don't I just go ahead and put a verse up and tell people how much God loves them? Because that's just the way Jesus is. Why don't I stop giving my opinion about everybody else? Because that's just the way what? Because the same person that you and me have a problem with is the same person that Jesus loves. You know what? Moses, here's how we're closing. Moses, you know what's interesting? Pastor Bill, you know, we never find out what happens to the bush. You know, in the story of Moses, what happens? We find out what happens to Moses. We find out what happens to the Israelites. We find out what happens to the Egyptians. We find out what happens to Pharaoh. We find out what happens to the soldiers. But we never find out what happens to that burning bush God came in the form of a burning bush. We never find out what happens to the bush. You know what I think? I think that bush is still burning. I think that bush is still burning, baby. I think he's looking at all of us and saying, I've got a calling for you. You can either run from it or choose to accept the call. That bush is flaming right now, baby. It's speaking to you and it's speaking to me. It's burning. You say, Pastor Aaron, but I don't see no bush. I come out my house every day, ain't nothing on fire. What's burning inside of your heart right now? What's burning inside of your heart? I don't gotta tell you. Pastor Bill doesn't have to tell you. Pastor Jim don't have to tell you. Pastor Jeremiah don't have to tell you. Pastor Eddie don't have to tell you. But there's a bush inside of some of us today, and it's burning, and you got to ask yourself the question, am I going to run from it, or am I going to accept it? What you going to do? What you going to do, church? We're not in this alone. Remember, we got Christ. Listen, we have to know our place before we can take our place in the circle of life. We have to know our place before we can take our place in the circle of life for God's kingdom. Are you with me? Are you with me? Are you with me? It's burning. Will you stand to your feet? I know we went long today, but it's okay. Hey, let me tell y'all something. The Super Bowl is 4 hours and we ain't gonna be complaining. And we ain't, hey, if I hear one person say we went a little too long today, I'm gonna slap you. I will slap you, okay? Because we gonna be partying for 4, 5, 6 hours today. Hey, will you answer the call? Will you answer the call today? The altar's open.